May the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be pleasing to you, my rock and my salvation. Amen. What is the biggest number you can think of? Kelly?
Infinity.
Infinity. That was an easy cop-out. Thank you, my math teacher. Anybody else who feels like a mathematician can give me a higher number than infinity, Kelly?
Infinity times infinity.
Oh my gosh, we've got a bunch of first graders with us this morning. I love numbers. Okay, I'm lying. I hate numbers, but do you know that 10,000 denarii, or 10,000 gold coins, and the time that this scripture was written, was the top number that you could amass in debt? It was the top. There was no more than 10,000 gold coins. That was it. In fact, it would take you a lifetime to pay that debt off. Now, at this point, is anybody itchy? Is anybody itchy? Is anybody giving any nervous tics when they're starting to think about their Visa, their MasterCard, their American Express, their diner's card, their mortgage, their rent, the electric bill? Maybe we should have Don go back and turn the lights out. It's amazing how we think of debt. You know, I heard a story of a business owner that in 2008 racked up an immense amount of debt in the housing market. See, he was a flipper. Does anybody know what a flipper is? These are these houses that are dog houses, as you might imagine. The carpet smell, the walls are rotting out, they may have plumbing, they may have not, and they come in and they flip these houses, all right? And flipping means they turn it from coal and they polish it up into a beautiful, sparkling diamond, and they sell it for a great profit. Well, this man was in a big metropolitan city, and he had 100 houses that he had flipped. But guess what? The market crashed. No longer was anybody loaning on these subprime mortgage loans, all right? Things were in the Johnny Flesher, if you will. The bank calls him up and says, it's time for you to get with paying us back. Now, the gentleman had a wife who was very beautiful. He had 3 kids that were also very beautiful, that were enrolled in a very nice private school, and they had the Mercedes, and they had the Escalade, and they had everything that went with it, but guess what? They couldn't pay for any of those things. So the banker came and said, we're going to take your houses, all 100 of them. We're not only going to take those houses for you to pay us back, because the market has devalued your property so much that guess what? They're not worth what you paid for them now. We're going to take the house that you live in and your beautiful wife and your kids. We're going to take the Escalade. We're going to take the Mercedes. We're going to take the boat that you happen to like very much. We're going to take your ski-doos. What's a ski-doo? Jet ski. Jet ski, that's right. We're going to take your snow-doo. I don't think there's a snow day. We're going to take your snowmobile. We're going to take everything you've got. And then you will be homeless. And we're going to do this all. We're going to go to the lawyers. And instead of a 30-day process, we're going to move it up to 15 days. Because by golly, we need our money back. Hearing this news, the young gentleman clutched his chest and began to hyperventilate. I think I would begin hyperventilating too. Things began to happen, and he began to cry unconsolably. Can you imagine crying unconsolably? Well, if you had taken all my 100 houses, my Escalade, my Mercedes, my house, my Ski-Doo, my Snow-Doo, things would be very upsetting too. Not only that, but they were taking away the way that he was to live, because that was, in fact, his living by flipping houses. Well, something happened in a banker's heart that day. Can you imagine that? Something happening in a banker's heart? Something happened in that banker's heart, and he was moved to tears. He began thinking of his wife and his children and began to really think about all that was at stake here for the children in the house. And he said, tell you what, we're going to put it off, all right? You just do what you can, and we'll just do what we can, and we'll move forward. Well, the young man was so happy to hear this, he went right home. And he began thinking of ways that he could pay the banker back. And you know, in the market crash, what happened with these houses? Were they sellable? No. So what did people do with them? They rented them out. Well, the young gentleman had a house where he had a tenant who was behind on the rent. So he went and got an eviction notice and said, pay me my money today, or I'm kicking you out. The rental didn't charge that much. It was only $350 a month, and he was behind three payments. 3 months he didn't pay rent. So he went and got an eviction and filed it in public court. But one morning, the banker, back in his own home, was sitting there drinking his coffee, reading over the paper, and sees the eviction notice that is in the paper. He threw down his newspaper and stomped off, and his wife goes, where are you going? I'm going to work. So he goes to work, and he begins immediately an active foreclosure on the young man who owned the 100 houses, the Escalade, the Mercedes, the Ski-Doo, and the Snowman. You know that parables can be retold in different ways? That was the same parable that Jesus told in a modern context. It's amazing the truth that comes to us when we look at what it means to truly forgive. And apparently in our times, money talks. Anybody hear that before? Money talks. It's amazing for us to think about this forgiveness that comes to us. The way in which we are able to live and love and begin to understand what it means to be a Christian people. In the United Church of Christ, we have adopted the just peace understanding. That we want people to live faithfully. We want them to live healthily. We want them to have accessibility to health care. We want them to be able to have clean water. We want them to live without the fear of being shot in their own homes. We want them to be able to live out their lives free of bigotry and hatred. We want them to live so that their true life, their true selves are realized. Have you ever had a glimmer of your true self? Many of us might have a vision of what that is, but it only happens for a second. Truly, you have those moments where you see how God looks at you as perfectly and wonderfully made. And when we have those moments, we have what Oprah would call is a what? Aha moment. We have those aha moments when we really understand what it means to be faithful followers of Jesus. We begin to listen to the teachings of Jesus in the Sermon on the Mount. We begin to see what it means to love and to forgive. Oftentimes I hear that forgiveness is not about the other person, but it's about you. Anybody hear that before? I'd like to say that it's true. But the reality what forgiveness does is it's about reconciliation and relationship. That the person that you forgive not only experiences the forgiveness, but also is able to revisit the relationship that was broken. And together you might move forward. This is also the text that we say, forgive 70 times 7. How many is that?
70 times 7?
Uh-huh. 490 times. All right, there you go. All right, you didn't know we were doing that this morning, did you? 490 times. Now, in the scripture, in the Bible, guess how many times you were supposed to forgive someone?
70 times 7.
How many?
70 times 7.
No, we're talking about in the biblical age. I'm sorry, I didn't make myself clear.
Every time.
Every time. No. What else? Any other numbers? How many?
Three.
Yep. Three strikes you're out at the old ball game. Three times, that's it. Oftentimes I hear folks, whatever someone does against you, I'll forgive you three times, but after that, it's it. We're done. No more relationship. I'm not calling you to Thanksgiving. That is off the table. I've had it with you. I wanted those pearls that mother had, and you did not give them to me. And you know how much I loved those pearls. Golly, this is some hard stuff. 31 years later, my sister would forgive me for a doll that fell out of a window when she was 3. That's a long time to harbor a grudge, isn't it? Over a Fisher Price doll that was made out of pink gingham. Can you imagine? It was an ugly doll. We all have things that we need forgiveness for. We all have ways in which we treat each other just like trash. We let ourselves get in front of the eight ball. We want it all about me, 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 me. It's easy to do. It's very easy to do because we want it just so. Some of us are more by the book, others of us are all over the map, and it drives people crazy. Can't you be more organized? Can't you just get things right? Can't you hang on to a schedule? It's all about love. See, Jesus didn't come to bring us schedules, folks. Jesus didn't come to give us timelines. Jesus didn't come to give us exacting details. Jesus also didn't come to let us be free and loose and messy in our lives. Jesus came to show us what it meant to be a loving people and to forgive. Does anybody know of a man named Anselm? Anselm. He's an old guy who lived in about the 12th century. He had everything figured out about how Jesus came into the world. You know that Jesus came into the world, according to Anselm, to pay a debt? You know that? He came into the world to pay a debt, and our debt was because we were sorry so-and-sos. When we look at the way that Jesus came into the world, his life, his ministry, we found that Jesus did not come into the world to pay a debt, but rather to show us how to live with each other and with ourselves. And in order to do that, we must first follow in the ways of peace and justice and love. When we do those three things, we find out what it means to be a faithful follower of Jesus. As we begin becoming that faithful follower, we begin to expand who we are, and we begin to see something. We begin to see that true self that God has given us to be. Not our imperfections, not the ways that we've lost our hair. We see the way that God loves us, And in return, we bounce that image off ourselves like we were little mirrors, shining brighter with the love of God in our hearts and in our minds. This is what it means to be a faithful follower of Christ. This is what it means to follow Jesus and understand why we forgive. Because it's all about relationship. Not breaking off what we have. Not saying, I'm mad at you today. I'm still mad about those pearls. But to get back together and see what's really important. Love, forgiveness, and a just peace. Amen.